Hello everyone, assalamualaikum. In this tutorial, we'll learn how to use Flutter BLoc for state management. Previously, we have seen some tutorials how to use Flutter Getx for state management, and here we'll have a very simple look about Flutter BLoc and basic understanding about it. Okay, so it's pretty much like Flutter Getx, which helps you to separate your business logic or logic from UI. So your UI just would be responsible for drawing, and a BLoc would be responsible for processing data and updating the states. So the basic idea about Flutter BLoc is that here it takes every user interaction and it takes them as events, and then it transforms into states and output it like that. Okay, so here if we have user UI, and if there is a button, so button press would be translated as events, and then it send it to BLoc. And if we have some data to process, it will process and send us data to BLoc again. And well, it happens internally. That's how we should understand it. And then the data is given to UI as states, but now the states is outputted as stream of objects. Okay, so that's the most basic idea about Flutter BLoc, and that's my understanding. And here we have to also understand some crucial parts or widgets or objects that would help you to further understand about Flutter BLoc. So first we have to know what is a BlocProvider. Okay, so you'd use BlocProvider to create BLoc or BLoc objects. That's how I understand. Okay, yeah, so this happens basically as initialization, and during this thing you can also initialize your necessary data that should be initialized. Okay, and after that definitely you'd call a BlocBuilder, and this should be within your widget in the view, and this works as a dependency injection. So once you have this BlocBuilder, you can access the most updated data, and you can also update your UI. okay, and this is also called from view, the same as the BlocProvider, which is also called from view. And one most interesting thing about Flutter BLoc is that, as I said earlier, that it converts events to states. So here with this function we can convert our event to states, which we'll see later how to convert it. And for dependency injection, which means that so for our app, the BLoc would be a dependency, so our UI has to access this thing, access the BLoc, and this is called dependency injection, and it happens through a BlocProvider.off helper function. Okay, yeah, so these four things are pretty important, and I laid it out here in order. Everything starts with BlocProvider, then BlocBuilder, and then actually a map to event, a event to state. Of course we need to use BlocProvider.off to inject the dependency so that we can map from event to state. So now let's take a look at our code. So as I said earlier, everything here is taken as inputs, and the output is states. Okay, so if I were you, first I'll go ahead and define our events. Okay, so we'll have two events. So one event for initializing data and another event for increasing our data value. Anyway, so for that we first defined abstract class, and our two events, they extended those class, and later on we'll see how we deal with some methods using these events. Okay, and those events would be later on also dealt with in our state. Okay, so if I were you, I would go ahead and define the events that you need. Okay, so that's the most simple way to understand BLoc. So once that is done, what I would do, I would go ahead and define our states. So BLoc events and states, they should have kind of one-on-one relationship. That's my understanding. Okay, so as we have event and counter increment event, so related to this one, we should see something pretty much in our state as well. Okay, so we'll come to our state. So here we declared a class. Okay, so the class name is counter state. It doesn't matter the prefix. And here we have a variable. So this is the variable that we want to use and increase the value. So here we have this initialization method, which I would say related to this one. And then, it does initialize count value to zero. And then we also have another method, which is called clone. So all it does is take the current value and save it and return it as a stream. Okay, so that's what it does. So about the stream, we'll very soon we'll see a little bit more. So this is for initializing the value, and this is once we change the value. If we increase the value, then we'll take the value and save it and return it. Okay, so these two are kind of related with these two methods over here. Okay, so once you have your events and states ready, then you can go ahead and create your actual block. Okay, so here I've created this class which is called counter block. Okay, so others two are counter state and events. Anyway, so here this class, the actual class that extends our block. Okay, so as we said earlier, that block maps event to state. So that's why here within block we are using events and state. Okay, so now block would know which events to grab and which event to which how to and for those events how to transform them to states. Okay, so if you come over here, you will see this thing. So block takes event and states. So these are event, these are states, and they are all defined here and here. Okay, so anyway, after that we initialize our init method, which is sitting inside over here. So when block initializes, we call this init method, and we also initialize our value. Okay, so whenever you extend blocks, you need to provide your event and state. So that's why we have created events and states at the beginning early in our tutorial. Anyway, so the next function that does the magic is this one. Okay, map event to state. So it takes all the events and convert them to states and then return them as a string. Okay, so here we have two events, init and counter increment event. So over here it is more like whatever event is a trigger, we can find them here, and once we find them here, from here we return them as stream, stream. As we are returning them as stream, so we use yield and async keyword. So they have to do with returning stream. Okay, so definitely once we initialize this one, okay, so this method over here would get called and get initialized. Okay, and definitely after that, if we want to increment the value, so once we click on a button over here, so if we click on a button over here, okay, so this increment method would get called how? From this function, which converts events to state. Okay, so Flutter would know that. So this is an event. Okay, but of course, this event we have to somehow connect to our block. Okay, so you'll get this code in the link below, so don't worry about the code. So anyway, so these two events we have here, init and increment. Okay, now you need to call this block, and first you need to initialize this block in your UI. Okay, and from the UI we can refer this events over here. Okay, so this is our actual UI over here. So counter page UI. So it extends a stateless widget because we are using blocks, so we don't need to create a stateful widget. So over here, we within the build function we return a block provider, as I said earlier. So block provider will be responsible for creating the actual block. So using this, we create the actual block block object and we initialize. So as we initialize, it comes over here to this block over here. Of course, before that, this function, init function over here gets called because it's in super constructor, okay? So the value gets initialized. Okay, and after that, we are ready to use our block, okay? Now, block provider takes create and child. So within create function or create callback function, we create the block. And then we also provide a child, the actual UI that would rely on the block, okay? That would also capture data, this data stream or the states that's output as a stream. So over here, we do the dependency injection, okay? So this is our dependency injection, okay? So this is the actual counter block class, which is we created earlier over here, okay? So with this, what do? You are able to use it, and you can create instance of this block. Once again, so this is our block. This block extends Flutter block, which is responsible for managing state. Anyway, so this is more like if you used Getx, Getx controller injection or binding dependency. Anyway, so now as we have access to the block using this block object, so using this block object, we can access underlying method of block itself. So this is an instance of block. So this block has some method. So one of them is add. Using this add method, we can add events to it. Okay, so this is an event which we declared early, and this event is coming from here. So that's what I told you. So that if you have events in your project, so you should define them in a separate file, okay, and extend the main class, which is, you can call it actually anything, it doesn't matter though. Okay, so anyway, so you can add events in your view. Okay, and then block would be notified after on pressed that there is an event and that has been added to the block. So once it is notified, so it would come over here in our block, and it'll try to map it. That means that actually it'll try to find that events exist or not. So in our case, we are trying to find the event using this conditional statement over here. Okay, and this is the magic function which I told you. It takes all the events and try to find the related states for it. Based on that event, it checks which event matches, and after that we can do whatever we want. And here we are using yield and async because we are returning a stream like this one. So if you want to return a stream, and the places where you need to return stream, you need to use the keyword yield, so it would help you to return stream. Okay, so now here, so this condition matches after the on page on pressed button has been clicked. So this condition would match over here. Eventually this one would be get called, this one would get called over here, and now over here the value would be increased. So the value is increased, okay, and then saved in this count variable using the clone method. And now the clone method we have declared early in our state, okay? So the block itself, so this is the core of the block for our application. So it does get to access to the events and the states, okay? Why it can do that? Because here we have during block initialization, we have initialized our events and our states at the same time, okay? So that's why it can access it. Anyway, so now if you come back to the app, of course you can click on it and it would work. All right, so this is the basic idea that how blocks work. So once again, if you want to work with block, pretty much for a simple app, you'll define your events and the related states, okay? And using those events and states, of course you'll create your block. Okay, now in the block itself, here you will have a stream which will be returned after mapping from event to state, okay? And the mapping is done through pretty much using this conditional statement, and based on that you can call other functions and do whatever you want to do. All right. And eventually when your blocking building has been done, just call it from your view and you should be good to go. So that's the basic idea how block works. Anyway, so for this code, you can download the code from the description and there is a link below there. So check it out. Thank you.